mentioned earlier, two-thirds of my kids are pretty much out of the home. But over Christmas break, one of the things that allowed us to all come together as one family is one movie. And that is our love for Finding Nemo. And the sequel that came out a few years ago, Finding Dory. One of the things I didn't realize until I did the research on this sermon series is that both movies contain a lot of biblical themes. And actually, we're going to be covering those biblical themes throughout the month of January. Now, if you're not familiar with the movie, and I apologize if you're not able to see this as well, this is Dory right here. And we're going to be talking about Dory, and this is some kelp. And Dory is a blue tang fish. And let me ask here, let me see a show of hands. Who has seen Finding Dory? And let me hear, what's her problem? She has short-term memory issues. That's right. And so we're actually going to see a clip. We're not going to watch all of it, but we're just going to, if you haven't seen the movie, you're just going to get a flavor of what Dory goes through and her short-term memory issues. And, of course, it's funny as well. So let's go ahead and watch just a clip.
I suffer from short-term memory loss.
Yes!
That's exactly what you say.
Okay. We'll pretend to be the other kids now.
Hi, Dory!
Ahoy there! You want to play hide and seek?
Okay.
We'll hide, and you count and come find us.
Okay, Daddy.
No, not Daddy. I'm the nice fish who wants to be your friend. Okay?
Okay, Daddy.
Now,
I'm hiding!
Now count to 10.
So what exhibit are you from?
This will be a good spot, so go ahead and There's a lot more to it, but just wanted to give you a flavor of what the movie is like. And you saw her quest, her identity. That's what Dory is looking for. She is searching for her family, searching for her identity. Now, those for us that are not fish, we also struggle with the same thing. We're searching for our identity. And it may, and I'm not talking about your driver's license or the passport that I shared with the kids or our Social Security card. I'm talking about the very question of who am I? Who am I now? Who am I at this point in my life? And when we think about it, that question runs very deep to our soul. Because our culture tells us that knowing our identity is a big deal. For example, let me tell you the story of Rachel Dolezal. Now, Rachel calls herself Nikeche Amori Dial, but she was born Rachel Dolezal. And she sparked a huge debate when Rachel claimed to be an African American. Now, that you don't think that's a big deal, but when her parents said, no, Rachel is actually born white. And then it became even a bigger deal when her brother came out and said that she had actually falsified her background so that she would become the chair of a local NAACP and to teach Africana studies at a local university. Rachel, or Nikeche, is just trying to figure out her identity. So what is identity? Well, it goes beyond race. And it can even go beyond gender. Let me give you an example. Say that you have a child that is born, and is born both male and female. You have to make a decision. And you don't quite know what to do, and so you make that decision, and you decide, well, okay, we're going to raise it as a girl. But then you're always kind of wondering, did I make the right decision? And so what you do is you buy her girl clothes, and you buy girl clothes, toys, and you have her participate in girl activities, because that's what society tells you to do. But the problem is, on the inside, that child thinks it's a girl. So identity is huge. And it really goes beyond calling oneself a male or a female or whatever race you have, or even as a Democrat or Republican or an independent or liberal or conservative. It's deeper than we realize. Now, if I had a whiteboard up here, I would ask you to come up and name your experience that is defining when it comes to your identity. For example, I've shared with you about my 7-year-old self. I still remember the year was 1980. I was sitting in the basement of my Uncle Gary's house watching Nebraska eventually get beat by Oklahoma. Now, what does that tell me about my identity? It says that I'm a huge Nebraska fan, and I also hate it when Nebraska loses. Now for you, what do you think you would write on this whiteboard up here? Would it be a marriage? Would it be becoming a parent? Would it be going into the military? Would it be starting a career? Would it be attending your first Nebraska game? Being part of a church? These events, these experiences shape your identity. But also what you believe about these events also shape who you are. You have cancer, or it's in remission. Do you believe that you are a victim of cancer, or do you consider yourself a survivor of cancer? It makes a difference. You've lost a job, or you changed jobs. Do you believe that you were wronged, or do you see it as an opportunity to try something new? What you believe about your experiences matter. Are you an alcoholic? Now that might mean that you are an addict or a chance at grace to start something new. Or maybe you've just received a gigantic inheritance. Do you believe it's all mine, or is it an opportunity to do something good and worthy? Our experiences in life, coupled with how we interpret them, shape our identity. This month we're going to go beyond the stories of Finding Nemo and Finding Dory, and look at our identity in Christ. And that's why we're calling the series Finding Jesus. because it means their identity goes deeper than the things that we tell ourselves. I remember having a conversation the first year that I went over to Africa in Ghana, and I was visiting with the family that was sponsoring us, and this family did well economically. They drove nice cars, they had several homes, they sent their kid to college here in America, and they pretty much single-handedly supported that little church that we visited. Now, they could have said to me, yes, we earned everything we got. Or we worked hard for what we have. Or we got what we deserved. Or we were in the right place at the right time. Or that church wouldn't exist without our financial help. But no. They looked at me and they said, we are so blessed by a God who loves us. They identified themselves as a child of God and they lived into it. So let's look at this identity through our scripture.
Our scripture is Matthew 4, 18 through 20. Jesus calls the first disciples. As he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who was called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, follow me, and I will make you fish for people. Immediately they left their nets and followed him.
Thank you. Here we have the story of these fishermen, Simon, Peter, and Andrew. So what do we know about their identity? Well, we know that they're brothers. We know that Simon Peter has two names for some reason. And we know that they're fishermen. And I would say that last one really is the key to the identity. So here's the deal. Jesus sees them exactly as they are. Jesus sees Simon, Peter, and Andrew, ordinary guys doing ordinary jobs, normal stuff, and if Jesus would have come up to them and would have said, who are you? They probably would have said, well, we're fishermen, or we're Israelites, or we're Galileans, or we are subjects of Rome. Their experiences pretty much dictated their identity. I know a pastor who takes the message of this scripture seriously. And when he meets new people, he asks them the question, who are you? And he says about 90% of the people that he meets and asks that question say, I don't know. And then they go back to their role. Someone might say, well, I'm an IT guy, or I'm a mom, or I'm a retired school teacher. I'm whatever. Essentially, he says, we identify ourselves by the roles that we play, or the hurts that we had, or that one success that we go back to time and time again. Now, sometimes that pastor says, about 10% of the people go a little bit deeper. And he says that he asked that question, and one time one person said, I'm a felon. Or, I have a child that's autistic. Or, I'm anorexic. Or, I'm a victim of child abuse. I think of the people that I have met over the 7 years that I have lived here. I lived paycheck to paycheck. I lost all my money to a shyster in Costa Rica, where I should have never left that job. And those are the responses of just the time when I worked at the bank. When I was serving wine at co-op, oh my gosh, you get alcohol into some people, and people really share about their identity. One of the things I learned here is that people really don't like their jobs. They don't like their boss. They don't like the regulations they have at their job. They don't like their customers. All of these things shape who we are. And that's what I love about this passage. When Jesus sees these two brothers, he recognizes who they are. Not what they did in the past. Not their occupation. Not who their boss is. Jesus didn't care if they were parents or not, Republicans or Democrats, working class or elite. No, he recognizes who they are. And he loves them. And he looks at them, and he recognizes who they can become. I mean, just listen to verse 19 again. And he said to them, follow me, and I will make you fish for people. Who have you been in the past doesn't define who you are to Jesus. what you've done, where you've been, who you were, what family you were part of. Now, yes, that is all important because it defines us as an individual. But for Jesus, it doesn't mean anything to who we can become. In the movie, Dory gets separated from her family. You saw it a little bit in that clip. And she begins to question who she is, and she begins this quest to discover just that. Now, as a pastor, I realize that people don't ask that question, who am I, until something dramatic happens. Until you get to that point, I like to call it the rock bottom moment. And you begin to ask that question. Maybe you lived a life in the bottle of alcohol or painkillers, and you've reached that moment where you come to me, or you come to a family member, or you come to a friend that you trust, and you begin to ask that question, who am I? Maybe it's not the bottle. Maybe it's a job. I have pastored all my life in rural Nebraska. And I believe one of the hardest transitions of any career is that of a farmer. I have visited with farmers, and when they tell me they retire, I say to them, I didn't know that there was no such thing as a retired farmer. And I've never had anyone disagree with me. I mean, there's just no way one can get that soil out of their hands, or not listen to the crop prices or the going rate for cattle and not think about their time on the ranch or the farm. Or how many times have we gone down the road and we see this truck going kind of slow, kind of jogging off to the right, and when we pass them, what do we see? They're just looking at the rows. Maybe it's not farming. Maybe you've lost a job through downsizing, or it just wasn't a good fit. Whatever. And at that point, you begin to question, who am I? But you know what is so amazing about this story? Is there's no rock bottom. We don't hear about months and years of no fish. There's no starvation here. I mean, these men are not ready to just jump off and change careers, and Jesus comes right at the moment. I mean, it's just perfect timing. No. Jesus comes along, and he calls them in the prime of their career, when things are going so well, and they listen. They truly listen to the voice of Christ. Now contrast that with one of my favorite stories. I love to tell it. I'm sure I've shared with you this story a couple times already. The man whispered, God speak to me, and a meadow lark sang. But the man did not hear. So the man yelled, God speak to me, and the thunder rolled across the sky, but the man did not listen. The man looked around and said, God let me see you, and a star shined bright. But the man did not notice. And the man shouted, God show me a miracle, and a life was born. The man did not know. So the man cried out in despair, touch me, God, and let me know you are here. Whereupon God reached down and touched the man, but the man brushed the butterfly off and walked away. Here's the thing. God could be trying to reach out to you and touch you at any moment. And it doesn't have to be at a moment, at a time of crisis. What happens on the beach with these men is they have their identity. And Jesus comes along and he gives them a new one. A new one in Christ. Now we have our identity in Christ. And it goes deeper than any identity that we think of ourselves. Just listen to these words from Paul. By putting his seal on us and giving us his spirit in our hearts as a first installment. God created you for greatness. Think about what those words mean. We are not defined by our past. We're not defined by our present, our future, by our hurts, our job, not by the family that we come from or the family we divorced from, not by the winning basket we made as a junior in high school, not by the field goal that we missed when we were in junior high, not by the girl we dated, not by that marriage that failed. We're defined by God. We're defined by the Holy Spirit. And of course, we're defined by Jesus Christ. The very Jesus who sees us for who we are. Not by how others see us. Not by how other people say about us. Not even by our successes, and certainly not by our failures. Not by our cars, not by our homes. Not how well our kids are doing in school or in careers, and not even if our kids are not going to church. But what if we can't get there? What if in our minds we are so shaped by what everyone tells us, or how we were defined in high school, or how we can't get rid of that baggage, or how we just can't get things right, all because we came from this family? Or we grew up on that side of the tracks, or we came from that side of the river. Paul again comes to the rescue. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Conform. That is the message of society. Transform. That is the message of God. But that's not the end of the story. I mean, if you look back at this message in Matthew, we find Jesus is waiting for a response. If you look at this, there's no command. Jesus doesn't order these people to get out of the boat. What we find here is that God is waiting for you. Waiting for your response. Even if you are 45 or 55 or 65 or 75 or 85 or 95 years old, God is waiting. Here's the reason why. God loves you. God doesn't look at your past. God doesn't care what your GPA was in high school, who you ran around with, or if you were a loner. God approaches you and knows exactly where you are right now. Now, I don't know how long it's going to take you to respond, but just listen to how long the time frame here is in verse 20. Immediately, they left their nets and followed him. The identity of a Christ follower started as soon as they heard his voice. So we're going to try an exercise here. We're going to hear the voice of Jesus. Now, how are we going to do that? I want you to repeat the same phrase back to me. This is straight out of the Bible, and this identifies you as a follower. Are you ready? I belong to God.
I belong to God.
I am chosen.
I am chosen.
I am a new creation.
I am a new creation.
I am forgiven.
I am forgiven.
I am included.
I am included.
I am secure.
I am secure.
I am complete.
I am complete.
I am not alone.
I am not alone.
I am loved dearly.
I am loved dearly.
I am redeemed.
I am redeemed.
My sins are canceled.
My sins are canceled.
I am made complete in Jesus.
I am made complete in Jesus.
I am a child of God.
I am a child of God.
I am a fisher of people.
I am a fisher of people.
No more chasing an identity here. You are a child of God. You are loved by God. You are complete in God. And now you are identified as a follower of Christ. Amen. It is a blessing always to have the ushers wait upon us.